Our scripture today gives us our final glimpse for the season of the encounters of the risen Christ with his disciples. Next week is Pentecost, and though we will hear some more from John, we will change our study a little. We are still in the midst of Jesus' third encounter with his disciples. There, after they had gone to the Sea of Galilee, gone fishing, and shared a breakfast with Jesus, there is more to the story. We'll be sharing it, and I'll be reading the words in yellow and invite you to read aloud together the words in white. When they had finished eating, Jesus said to Simon Peter, "Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these?" "Yes, Lord," he said, "you know that I love you." Jesus said, "Feed my lambs."
Again, Jesus said, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" He answered, "Yes, Lord, you know that I love you." Jesus said, "Take care of my sheep."
Third time he said to him, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" Peter was hurt because Jesus asked him the third time, "Do you love me?" He said, "Lord, you know all things. You know that I love you." Jesus said, "Feed my sheep." I like that. It kind of reminds you of a high school romance. And you wonder whether, in some respects, this isn't Jesus speaking to a man with an adolescent mind. Andrew McGee was a professional golfer appearing at the 2001 Phoenix Open, standing on the tee of the 17th hole. It was a 342-yard par 4. The group ahead of him was still on the green, finishing up, ready to put their ball into the hole and move on. And it wasn't unusual when one group was on the green for the next group to go ahead and tee off. McGee knew that he wasn't a particularly long driver, that there wasn't any risk of the ball coming anywhere near the men on the green. But as it turns out, McGee had just double bogeyed the previous hole and was particularly disappointed or angry or frustrated or something, and particularly seemed to have been filled with that extra burst of adrenaline. So when he teed off, he must have hit it as hard as he possibly could, because the ball flew, and it flew, and it flew, and it bounced, and it bounced, and it bounced, and it rolled, and it rolled, and it rolled. And the men on the green saw that this ball is coming our way. They tried to warn each other, but not everyone saw it coming, not everyone heard the warning, including fellow golfer Tom Byron, who was beginning to situate himself over his ball, ready to finish his putting. The ball apparently came rolling up behind him, between his legs, hit the blade of his putter, ricocheted 8 feet, and into the hole. It's the only recorded hole-in-one on a par 4 in a PGA tournament, right? Wow. And it happened because of the assist, the unwilling, the unknowing, the undesired assist of Tom Byron, who, while everyone else was amazed and laughing and chuckling, was not at all happy about this whole event. Golf, you understand, in most circumstances, is not a team sport. So you don't usually count on the assist from another golfer in such a way. I say all this because it does, I think, reflect upon part of the lesson that is occurring in this final encounter, or this particular encounter of Jesus with his disciples, particularly in regards to Peter, who perhaps a little like McGee, was on his own mission. He had his own course, he had his own intentions, he had his own way of thinking, his own way of behaving, and he has, seemingly, ever since we first met him on a boat, or on the shore next to the boat, the older brother of the younger brother, who apparently was used to getting bossed around by Simon. Simon continued to reflect this independent concept later on when he was sure that he understood things the others perhaps didn't understand. He is perhaps best known for making the claim, and this is a paraphrase, that even if all these other fools desert you, you can count on me. Builds great teamwork, that kind of thing. You can count on me. He was so sure of himself, and yet when he was all alone and faced, confronted by questions of other people he encountered, when he was asked, "You're a follower of Jesus, aren't you?" He denied it. He denied it three times. One of those, we're told, was a young servant girl. So this strong, independent, self-sufficient, confident, sometimes arrogant man was intimidated by a servant girl, unwilling to even acknowledge that he was a follower of Jesus. Be careful when you think about that too much, it may sound kind of. Even here, after the resurrection, after encounters with Jesus, as this third encounter begins, they are gathered together out by the sea, doing nothing when there certainly was lots of things they could be doing. And what do we hear? We don't hear Peter saying, "Hey guys, why don't we go fishing? We'll at least make some use of this time we're out here." He didn't say, "Hey, you know, guys, let's just go out and see what we can do together." Right? What Peter announces is, "I am going fishing." The others say, "Okay, we'll come along," as if they were invited. But they weren't necessarily, "I am going fishing." Later on, after the unsuccessful catch, and then Jesus redirects them and they catch this large quantity of fish, and John points out, "Hey, that's the Lord up there." As soon as Peter hears it, we're told, he threw on his garments and he jumped into the water and rushed toward Jesus on his own. He didn't stay and help the other guys row. He didn't encourage him and say, "Oh guys, let's move together. Our Lord is on the beach." He charges ahead. When Jesus says, "Bring me some of those fish," Peter doesn't say, "Hey, you know, Andrew, Thomas, hey guys, let's go get some of the fish from that net." No, he goes to the boat by himself, drags the net ashore. You see the pattern. Some interesting things when Jesus finally decides to confront, lovingly, carefully trying to heal a broken relationship, because it is decidedly broken. Peter would vividly remember his denial. In an attempt to be honest and restore relationships, Jesus asked, "Simon, do you love me more than these?" A couple of things. He's calling him Simon, not Peter. Earlier in Scripture, he has changed the guy's name. He said, "You're no longer Simon, you are Peter," which means rock. "And on this rock I will build build my church. We're not sure it's Peter anymore. We're not sure there's any confidence in her anymore. We don't know if Jesus can trust him. We don't know if Peter knows if he can trust himself. Just the way we are when we have failed miserably. It's not only other people whispering about us and pointing at us, it's our own selves wondering, can I ever pull this back together? Can I ever recover from that big a failure? Can I ever forgive myself and move on? Simon, do you love me more than these? And yes, like everything else in Scripture and church history, we don't know and we debate about what these is. Some speculate, well, these are a large number of fish. And it would be an appropriate question. Simon, do you love me more than this life as a fisherman, than the catch, than the challenge, than the victory, than the success, than the business, than your heritage, than what you grew up doing? Because after all, even after I breathed my spirit on you and the other disciples, you remained hidden in a room for a week, and now you come out to the lake and you just sat there as if you had nothing else to do. When there are plenty of people out there to be ministered to, plenty of people who need to hear what only you can tell them. But instead you sit, and in the moment, with all the pressure off, you go back to what's natural, to what's you. And it's fishing. Simon, do you love me more than fishing? Because I'm calling you away from that life to a life of ministry, to a life of service, of witness. If you don't love me more than fishing, then we all better understand that right up front. The same thing you would say to any of us. If we don't love Jesus enough to set aside some other parts of our life in order to commit ourselves to service, it's really healthy that we know the truth about ourselves. Simon, do you love me more than these? Simon, do you love me more than these other disciples? Do you love me more than your brother? And more than Thomas over here? And more than these two guys that weren't even named? Because he would have claimed so in the past. He might have not have said it exactly that, but he had said very specifically, right? Even if they don't have enough faith, I do. Even if they aren't fully committed to you, I am. I am the exception amongst the group. He's made that claim in the past. So we're asking him again, do you love me more than these? Perhaps we're waiting for him to repeat the same mistake and say, of course I do. Of course I love you more than all of these other people. In which case we're looking for him to say, yes, I love you more than these. Which would be something else Jesus would have to correct over time. Simon comes back with a rather simple, non-specific, yes, Lord, I love you. Yes, Lord, I love you. You know that I love you. You know all things. Seemingly, if he was baited to presume some sort of superior position, he's not gone there now. He's perhaps learned his lesson, perhaps been humbled by his own failure, by his own failure. Maybe he's learned a lesson that it's not all about him. It's not about him rising to some sense of superiority, ruling over the weaker, lesser followers. Instead, Jesus teaches him, if you truly love me, you will serve the people around you. You will tend the sheep, you will feed the sheep, you will care for the lambs. people who love me will serve those around me. It's not a matter of domination or control or manipulation or anything that smells of superiority. We are called to a life of service. That's what loving Jesus means. And Peter was perhaps the first one that needed to learn that lesson the hard way. I am sure he's not been the last. Simon, do you love me more than these? In general, says something about what love is. Love is not just that warm fuzzy we first felt the first time we had a crush on someone. Nothing wrong with that. Love is not just that sense of infatuation that becomes for some people so addictive that we just bounce from one infatuation to another when life gets challenging. Relationships get complicated, it's balance time. Love is a series of constant choices, seemingly continuous decisions. And we show our love by the decisions we make, the priorities in our lives, and the way we decide how to live our lives. What is most important? How do we choose a family over a job? How do we choose a spouse over the multitude of other possibilities in the world? How do we choose taking care of ourselves versus serving the God of gold and power? How do we choose God over the other forces that entice us, that seduce us in life? It's a matter of individual, conscious, deliberate decisions. I'm deciding to do this. I'm deciding to go to worship. I'm deciding to contribute to the offering. I'm deciding to help with this ministry. I'm deciding to sing the hymn and be part of a congregation. I'm deciding to shake hands or hug or greet or celebrate other people. I'm deciding to offer prayers on behalf of these other people. I'm deciding to be part of a team. I'm deciding to recognize I'm not self-sufficient or independent, but I am willing to offer my gifts in service to a group effort to answer the call of Jesus. Some of those decisions are easy, some of them are very difficult, some of us haven't quite made yet. Some of us are still in process of figuring out God's call for us and how we can fully live into this life of service, this exhibition of love. It is a love that we have known from the people in our lives who have cared for us. And it is our great flaw how often, how incredibly frequently we fail to recognize the choices that those people who love us have made. How many times they have chosen us over the many other options to spend a few minutes with us, or an hour or a day, our lifetime, to devote their attention to us, to sacrifice other possibilities in order to be caring for us. We take it for granted, we miss it altogether, and therefore rob ourselves of the understanding of how deeply and powerfully we are loved, and how grateful we can be for those people who have made those decisions day after day, time after time, to care for us instead of any number of other endeavors. And certainly if we miss it in the people with whom we encounter, the people we encounter face to face in our homes, then we most certainly miss it in the other people around us. We most certainly miss it from the God that we don't get to see face to face, except the reflection of God we see in those people who love us. Which I think is good news, because it tells us that no matter how much we already believe we have been loved, and however grateful we are to the people for the love they've shown us, there's still even more that we haven't yet claimed, and we haven't yet rejoiced over, and we haven't yet celebrated. There's more love for us than we have yet imagined. And all we need to do is look, and we will find it. Seek, and ye shall find, he says. It must have been terribly difficult to communicate with a group of men out on a fishing trip. I can't imagine they were all that well in touch with their feelings. And yet, God, through Christ, has made this very powerful, direct connection to them, so that in the end they may feel more powerfully connected to one another and their God, so that in the end they may discover the love that flows into them and through them, so that they may together discover the true purpose in their life is not to seek and not to dominate people with wealth and power, but to simply serve.
Yes.
They wonder what their life is about, and they've been given the answer, and so have we. Let us pray. And we are incredibly grateful, oh God, that you have taught us how to look for that which we were seeking, that you have even taught us that what is truly important, truly powerful, truly loving, life-changing in our lives may not be the things that we've been told and the things we've imagined. That it's not hitting the lottery or inheriting a fortune or dominating others and rising to the top on their backs. But it is in seeking your love and celebrating your faithfulness and in sharing that love with others, and serving them in such a way that we can become a small part of this marvelous thing you're doing. We pray, O God, that you continue to do your work, and that we'll have eyes to see it, and that we will discover our place in the effort, so that others may continue to discover this life-changing love that you've shown us. In Jesus' name.